HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Apprentice in Wonderland, How Donald Trump and Mark Burnett Took America Through the Looking Glass, by Ramin Setoodeh, read by Roger Wayne. To my dad, who is voting for him. But I don't want to go among mad people, Alice remarked. Oh, you can't help that, said the cat. We're all mad here. Lewis Carroll. Don't forget, when it first went on, everybody said, no way. Who's going to watch Trump on television? It's not going to work. And you know, it worked. And they want to renew me as long as I live, I guess. Donald Trump on Fox News, February 2015. Prologue. Into the boardroom. Donald Trump is back in the boardroom, but as reality TV's ultimate boss slumps in his chair 25 floors above Manhattan, the cameras are nowhere to be found. It's August 2021, the summer after Trump was voted out of the White House. His president, in exile's most adoring fans and his most ardent detractors, probably think he's at Mar-a-Lago or Bedminster. Yet Trump has covertly made his way back to the city he loves, and he's agreed to meet me here at Trump Tower to relive his TV glory days. Clad in his familiar armor of a boxy suit and too long necktie that became his trademark as the Donald, he's going to travel back in time with me to 2004. That's when his reality TV series, The Apprentice, became a national phenomenon, transforming Trump into an unlikely blue-collar folk hero with swagger, comedic timing, and world-class negotiating chops. Trump, until then a New York celebrity who was pushing his way forward with the help of the tabloids, suddenly blew up as America's most famous businessman. Trump's four-year presidency has been a kaleidoscope of distortions and fake news, ending with an attempted coup. The country has moved on, or so it seems, from Trump, and Trump seems, for the moment, to have moved on as well. He lost his Twitter privileges because of his role in inciting the insurrection on January 6, 2021. Without a platform on which to rant in 280-character bursts about the injustices he's facing, Trump essentially disappeared. But on this afternoon, he has reason to crack a smile. He's about to do something that's going to remind him just how powerful he used to be. He's going to revisit some of his best exchanges as NBC's top reality TV moneymaker, to remember a simpler time when he knew exactly what to say and when everybody, not just his partisan loyalists, looked up to him. There are a lot of big moments, Trump says. I press play on an 11-minute video that I've edited together of key scenes from The Apprentice. The clips range from the three times he axed the troublemaker contestant, Omarosa Manigault. He could never stay mad at her and later made her a top aide in his White House, to crowning Joan Rivers the winner of the second celebrity edition of the series. It is true, isn't it? He asks, boasting about his unique perch in popular culture. I assure the former leader of the free world that yes, his reality TV series changed history. The conference room that we're in today has the generic feeling of a workspace that could exist anywhere, with a scuffed-up long wooden table, a TV projection screen, and rolling chairs. Only if you squint, though, does it resemble the boardroom from The Apprentice. In a way, we're on a working set. The NBC series was shot in Trump Tower, and Trump charged the show's creator, Mark Burnett, hundreds of thousands of dollars to lease office space. Okay, so we had two floors of this building, big floors, taken up by The Apprentice, Trump says after we watched the scene in which he first uttered the words, you're fired, on TV. Down below, we had the boardroom. There were hundreds of people that worked on the show. You know, this television stuff is great. You'll think they'll have like two cameras? He pauses for effect. They had two cameras on every person, especially after it became a big hit, actually. Trump goes on to say that he improvised the catchphrase that helped propel the series into the ratings stratosphere. The show cast Trump as a no-nonsense CEO tasked with gleefully firing mediocre job candidates and later celebrities who couldn't cut it in his version of the high-stakes world of corporate America. "When I said you're fired, the whole building shook," Trump says of that first episode. "Everybody, because they have so many screens, they saw what was going on in the boardroom. The place just reverberated. People were screaming. They were shouting. The crew, the makeup people. Everyone was watching it. There were hundreds of them, and they went crazy." He sounds like a retired high school football coach, lounging in a diner in the middle of the day, rewinding the clock on his favorite plays. As a storyteller, Trump can struggle with facts, the chronology of events, and what exactly he accomplished as president, but the details of that day from more than 17 years ago flow freely. "In fact," he says, "they had to stop the tape. They had to get them to shut up because you can't have that." Although, Trump seems to imagine the sound of a crew cheering for him again right now. "They could have left it. It would have been interesting. But the people in their homes went crazy too, because that first night when it aired, that first show, I got calls from people that I hadn't spoken to in years. They said, that was the most unbelievable show." As he crisscrosses through time, his brain misfires. Even he can't accept that a version of himself existed that was once broadly uncontroversial and popular. "So it actually got very good reviews, which is hard for me because they hate to give me good reviews," Trump says. "I got unbelievable reviews. Now that was before my political days, okay? You know." Trump makes a face like a toddler being forced to eat his vegetables. If this were a scene from a reality show and not real life, the producers might cut to a confessional booth where Trump would look into the camera and admit that he regretted running for president and that starring in The Apprentice was the best job he'd ever had. Of course, on The Apprentice, Trump, unlike the contestants, never gave confessional interviews. By issuing commands and beheading the unworthy, he was simply the voice of God. He squints at me from across the room.
"Go ahead. Show me another one."
And so I play another clip. And another one. And another one. Chapter 1. Keeping Up with the Trumps. Throughout his career as a real estate mogul, Donald Trump agreed to practically every interview request that came his way, because he believed there was no such thing as bad publicity. He followed the same strategy as a reality TV star. That's how I first started talking to him in 2004 as a 22-year-old reporter at Newsweek covering The Apprentice. Most celebrities employ a publicist to field their interview requests, but such a system proved too bureaucratic and perhaps too costly for Trump. Instead of going through a PR flack, I'd call his office at Trump Tower, and his secretary, Norma Federer, would patch me through to his desk, or cell phone, so quickly that Trump wouldn't even stop to ask which publication was on the other line. "I love Newsday," was a regular salutation. After I'd then tell him that I was actually calling from Newsweek, he'd restart our conversation by listing off new superlatives, leaving the poor reporters at Newsday in a ditch. Nearly 20 years later, when I announce in the press I'm writing this book, Trump reaches out to me through his office, offering to be the first person I interview. And given the circumstances, that he's not only the central figure of my book, but a former U.S. president engulfed in scandal, I expected that I'd need to work much harder to track him down. Once we get started, he keeps extending our time together, which would spill over into follow-up appointments. "Okay, so why don't we do another meeting?" is how we'd usually end our sessions. Sitting across from him with my prepared list of questions, there was no way to contain our conversations just to The Apprentice. He haphazardly swings from one monologue to the next. A question about a contestant cascades into a defense of his leadership as POTUS, and then he swings back to the 2000s again. On some days, I have the feeling he has no idea whom he's even talking to. At our second meeting, he tells me he couldn't remember sitting down with me, even though it was only a few months earlier, a startling admission about his short-term memory. "That was a long time ago," he says. But each time we meet is another chance to drum up press for himself to prove that he still matters. And there is something about talking about The Apprentice that soothes him like a calming chest balm applied to a patient with pneumonia. If this comes out right,
it's such a great thing, Trump explains.
The true story has never been told. Even though I'd witnessed how untethered Trump had become in public during his press conferences from the White House and other public appearances, meeting him in person means experiencing the former president on another level. In the spring and summer of 2021, he looks lonely, a shadow of a famous person. He seeks validation from even the tiniest groups of humans, assembled in his office on any given day, badgering his advisor Jason Miller or Deputy Communications Chief Margot Martin to voice their approval aloud as he tells stories about how much better he'd be than Sleepy Joe or how unfairly the media treats him. In other ways, for all that he'd visibly aged, the presidency hasn't fundamentally changed him, not as a man nor as an interview subject who'd never learned how to listen in a conversation. He pivots to his vendettas and lashes out about his many enemies, from Dr. Anthony Fauci to the MSNBC host Lawrence O'Donnell to the Will and Grace star Deborah Messing.
"She's brutal," Trump hisses,
admitting that he'd spent time in the White House closely monitoring the Twitter account of a sitcom actress. Here is the 45th president of the United States of America, trapped behind a desk in a corner office inside his own glass tower, with a bare-bones staff, an empty calendar, and hours of unfilled time. I never know when our afternoons together will end. There's always the possibility that if things went extremely well, Trump could keep talking at me through dinner, and maybe I'd have to excuse myself to escape from him. For my first interview in May 2021, I take a car to Trump Tower. The stillness on Fifth Avenue reflects the widely held belief by most New Yorkers that Trump has permanently fled their city. There are no crowds to mark his presence in the form of MAGA fans or curious tourists. The skyscraper that shields him from a Manhattan that no longer wanted to be associated with him had its own history, most notably as the recurring co-star of The Apprentice and the site of the escalator that he famously rode down in 2015 to announce his first run for president. Now, all these years later, Trump Tower feels like Grey Gardens without the cats. Within these walls, there are ghosts of Trump's past. When I enter the lobby on my first visit for this book, a security guard waves me upstairs after checking my name off a list, but he doesn't wand me or pat me down for weapons. This is exactly how I entered the building years ago as a reporter with an appointment to see the Donald. I'm surprised just how easy it is to physically access him. I'd gone through heavier security at concerts and museums. Inside the elevator, someone has stuck a faded Make America Great Again sticker next to the buttons. 26 floors up, I encounter Trump via a papier-mâché bust of his head, sitting on top of a cabinet in a hall. I'm reminded of the faded billboard in The Great Gatsby, featuring the vacant eyes of the optometrist Dr. T.J. Eckelberg. There's something about the quiet inside Trump Tower that feels like a department store past its prime. The reception area, often featured on the show, has lost its sheen. Rona Graff, an assistant who shot to fame on The Apprentice for telling the contestants when Trump was ready for them in the boardroom, has left her position. She was subpoenaed in 2022 by the New York Attorney General during a probe of the Trump Organization's finances. The only reading material within sight are old copies of Trump Magazine, a vanity publication that folded years ago. On this afternoon, a longtime Trump associate, Meredith McIver, the former ballerina and a professional ghostwriter who took the blame for plagiarizing Melania Trump's speech at the 2016 Republican National Convention, is manning the desk, dressed like Cruella de Vil in a white Dalmatian spotted jacket and leopard flats. A secretary assists her with answering phones. Eavesdropping on her conversation with a young Secret Service agent offers a window into the lives of Trump's staff. It sounds as if they were being held against their will inside their ruler's bunker. "We've seen a lot of action in these halls over the years," the secretary says. "Things were always changing." "It's very exciting," she cries out, trying to convince herself as much as her conversation partner. Then she picks up the phone and puts on a chirpy voice. "Trump Organization." As soon as she hears who is on the other line, she quickly hangs up. "This guy is screaming in Russian, not an English word," she says. "There's always a crank caller you can just count on." Somehow the Russians are always finding a way to crash into Trump's orbit. The phone starts to ring again. "There he is," She switches over to her secretary voice. Trump Organization. And then she hangs up again. The Secret Service agent shuffles his feet.
Were you able to go outside today? She asks him. It's really pretty.
I worked in the motorcade, so I rode in, he says. The agent scoffs as he glances down at his suit. I don't think people like me because I look like a detective.
I didn't think about that, she says. You're suspicious?
The last thing I want to do is get in a fist fight. I want to grunge down a little bit so I don't attract attention.
It's hard to blend.
The phone keeps ringing, but now she's ignoring it. He's still calling? The agent asks, and the secretary nods. He goes on. Do you get a lot of protesters?
Not that much. They are pretty minor. That would cause too much consternation.
She holds on to the last word, raising her eyebrows long enough to suggest that Trump wouldn't tolerate such a thing. Suddenly the room gets quiet, and even the phone calls from Russia stop. You have a rough job, the Secret Service agent says.
Fortunately,
I'm only in for an hour when he's here, the secretary says, blinking a few times to show that she hasn't surrendered to a hostage situation.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.